honored and privileged to be speaking to you tonight about my journey, okay? So I've entitled my talk tonight, My Journey from Augusta, Georgia, USA, to the Bank of England. Little background behind this. More so, I guess it occurred when I had moved to London in 2002, and I was still in my executive career. More than likely, we would have American business people coming over, and they would meet me, and one of the first things that they would ask was somewhere along, I'd say probably within the first 15 or 20 minutes, how did a girl, where are you from in the States? I'm one from Augusta, Georgia. How did a girl from Augusta, Georgia get to London, England, or to, you know, Lloyd's of London, or whatever? And I would sarcastically say, on a plane. And they didn't quite know how to take that, right, you know. And anyway, I went along and with my little sarcastic remark back, because I also took it as, how did you really get from Augusta, Georgia to London, to AIG or whatever? So I was really, I began to think about it, and I said, well, how did I get, what is my journey? Because I've basically been on this journey, not really looking back and not really tooting my own horn or whatever, just getting on with doing the job. So I took some time out, and I decided that it has been a journey. Okay, so I'm a storyteller, and I like pictures, so hopefully you guys will work with me here. So, beginning, as I said, I'm from Augusta, Georgia. That is my home house on the far left of the screen. It is probably less than a 10-minute walk from the Augusta National Golf Course. So any of you folks in here that are golfers? Oh, okay.
Talking.
Okay. So basically, maybe it was something I said about Augusta, right? Okay, so that's Augusta. Quite proud of that picture because it does show the days that we're in London. Got it. Thank you. And then on the far left, you see the fresh face of a 17-year-old from St. Thomas Aquinas High School. So that's 1977. 41 years ago. Okay, so from there to me standing here in front of the Bank of England, that represents 41 years. The top half is my brother. He's a surgeon in the U.S. Bottom, my brother, my dad, and myself in our backyard. My late mom, many years ago, passed away. Me with the governor, of course, and Don Butler. That was actually last year at the Bank of England, the celebration of the 30th anniversary of Black History Month in this country. So we had Don Butler there, and it was a fabulous event, and we got the governor out. So that was a big deal. And of course, I like this shot of the governor's garden, which most people do not get a chance to see. You always see the front facade of the bank. But basically, this represents 41 years, so that's where I started, and this is where I'm at on the journey, if you will. So, career roadmap. So, as I said, started in the left Augusta in the fall of 1977, and yes, I'm proud to give dates. fall of 1977, going to Tennessee State University in Nashville, Tennessee. Business management major, graduated in 1981. My first job was with Continental Oil Company, or Conoco as it was called. And because I was not an engineering major, but I was hired for a technical role, I went through an offshore training program where I spent six month training program going in and out of the Gulf of Mexico. So in 1981, I was one of the first women at Continental Oil Company sent in the Gulf of Mexico to live on the oil rigs for 7 days on. And that was a part of my training. So I learned the oil industry from geology all the way to refining, which was quite something back in 1981, if you can imagine. So I worked for Continental. Conoco in Texas and Louisiana for 6.5 years. Price of oil bottomed out in the mid-80s, and I had a forced career change. No other oil companies were hiring, were drilling, because price of oil had gone below $20 a barrel back then. So, basically, what did I do? I started insuring petroleum companies. So, this whole SVP part in there, basically that begins around 1987. I started over again after a 6.5 year career with Conoco, and I started insuring petroleum companies. So I worked for Chubb and Son, which was a big company in the U.S. at that particular time, and had several roles progressively more senior with Chubb, with Transamerica, with AIG. First time around, I've had two tours with AIG, so first time with AIG. Then I went to New York, and so I should back up, I'm getting ahead of myself. So I started at Chubb, I started my insurance career back in Atlanta. So I left Louisiana, went back to Georgia, started over again, started with Chubb in Atlanta, went to Chubb Charlotte, Chubb Richmond, Chubb Atlanta, Chubb Charlotte, Chubb Richmond. Came back to Charlotte to open up an office of Transamerica Insurance Company, went to Dallas with Transamerica Insurance Company, and then went to AIG in Philadelphia. So count all the times that I've been moving, okay? People would say this was back in the day when you actually wrote people's addresses in address books. Millennial, yeah. So they started putting my address in pencil so they could erase it because I was moving so much. But ultimately ended up in New York as a reinsurance broker with Cedric Ree, which is now known as Marsh McLennan or Guy Carpenter. And then along the way, AIG called me back to help open the U.S. operation of the Bermuda-based company. So I went back to AIG. And during the time that I was a reinsurance broker at the Marsh company, I had started placing business in London and Germany. And so I got the bug that, you know, maybe I might want to do something outside the U.S. Maybe I might want to actually go to Europe and work in Europe. And ultimately, I did go back to AIG to help start the operation. I was vice president of the East Coast, so it was basically production underwriting major corporations in the U.S. And then 9/11 happened. And that was a very difficult day for me. I lost a lot of friends. I saw planes go in. I was supposed to be in the building. My colleague went to a meeting that I didn't go to, and unfortunately, he didn't make it out. So it was very traumatic for me. And quite frankly, I decided that I had this inkling that I wanted to move abroad, and I decided that was what I was going to do. So I literally went into my president and said, I came to this company, you told me when I came back that you would let me go to Europe and work in Europe. I'm still here, but I'm going to Europe with or without this company. 6 months later, I'm in London. So that was 2002, came to London. Basically, I ran a global portfolio for this AIG operation and traveled around the world with Shell Oil, Rio Tinto, Siemens, any of the major Fortune 500 companies that you can think of, we were actually insuring. That was part of the portfolio that I was responsible for. And we grew it to $100 million U.S. dollar portfolio. Somewhere along the way, Lloyd's of London decided that they were interested in me coming to work for them. So I was headhunted to go into Lloyd's of London. This would have taken us to 2008 then, and I was appointed deputy head of syndicate underwriting performance. So for at that time, when I was there, we had anywhere from 80 to 90 syndicates operating within the Lloyd's market. I opined on all of the business plans and was one of the ones that actually approved syndicates coming into the Lloyd's market. That was, so that was Lloyd's, and then we basically had a restructuring. I took time out, I had garden leave. I figured by 2013, I served a rest, you know. So I took some time out, and while I had some time out, I looked around and I said, what is it that I haven't done after all these years that I'd like to do? Maybe it's time to retool, do something a bit different, okay? So I decided to sign up Boston University, and I received a Master's of Science in Business Continuity, Security, and Risk Management. At the ripe old age, I completed that work at 57. Mm-hmm. So, and people looked at me, you're crazy, right? You've had this career, you're going back to school, why? I decided it was something I wanted to do, and that degree, actually, when I started to come back and get back in the market and think about what I want to do, it really set me up very well to be appointed as a senior advisor to the Bank of England's Prudential Regulation Authority, because it was it allowed me to understand a lot of the issues that are going on now: technology, operational resiliency, risk, how do you evaluate risk, also looking at capitalization and risk models and things of that nature. So it set me up all of the journey to this point, to the Bank of England, and I think I have some other places to go after this, but I'm there now. But this is how, if you followed that whole, you know, 41 year, I can't believe it myself, it's all in one slide, wow. Anyway, but after all of that, my three key things, if you don't remember anything else I've said tonight, three keys to success to me actually revolve around the confidence, risk-taking, and relationships. And the confidence piece didn't say too much about my family, but I grew up in a family of very well-educated and very successful people. My mom was an educator. She happened to get her first master's in New York University in 1963. My grandmother, my grandparents, my father was a successful businessman. I've got a brother that's a subspecialist consultant surgeon, you know. So we were a pretty competitive family, I put it that way. And I just remember that, you know, my parents always said, look, you've got, you know, private school education, which I guess would be considered public here, but, you know, you've got a great education, you've got, you know, and I basically drank the Kool-Aid, you know. I never really bothered myself with worrying about what you're black, you're a woman, you're from the South, you're from this and other, because to me, I was just as good as anyone else. I mean, I was one of the few who saw my high school picture. I was one of the few minorities all the time, you know, in that particular situation. So I just did not, okay. I'm giving that. That's my timer. Bottom line is, I'm not naive, and I know that certain people, you know, may have had prejudices against me in some of the roles that I've had, and they probably still do now. But quite frankly, I don't spend my energy worrying about what other people think of me. If I've got the job, I say that's positive affirmation, okay? And I get on and do the work, and most of the time people do, or all the time people basically have respected me and respected my work. Risk-taking, I hope that I illustrated through that whole journey, that 41-year journey, about the risk that I have taken. I have not, and I'm proud of the fact that I've had a career that has taken me into different areas, and I think that I come out now, at the ripe old age of 58, I think I come out a pretty interesting person and a diverse person, and I'm very proud of that. So what I would say is, I would encourage people, even if opportunities come about, and you may say, well, I don't have all those, can't tick all the boxes that are the requirements, but if you feel that you have, the confidence, and if someone is offering you a position, but you don't think that you have, well, that means that other person must obviously see something in you. So if someone else has confidence to offer you a role or to say, would you consider doing this, they obviously see something in you that you might not see. So I would say go for it. And that is professional risk taking, okay, okay. Relationships, I use the term relationships. A lot of people use networking. Networking is fine. To me, networking really feels clinical. I prefer to use the term relationship. And actually, I must say that all of the jobs that I tried to run through in very quick very quick time frame. I got them via relationships. The Bank of England, the appointment relationship, all of the jobs relationship, other than my very first job that I got when through the careers office at Tennessee State University. And my last few slides, many people talk about role models, and I have a lot of role models. My mother, as I said, my parents, but one of my role models was Coretta Scott King, who is the late wife of Martin Luther King. And I note for the ladies in the room, and maybe some of the men know, the suffrage colors are purple, green, and white. So that is why I chose the color schemes purple and green for my slide. And it turns out that Coretta Scott King has the purple one, which I thought was interesting. And her son there has his tie. But her statement there resonates with me because this statement was made almost 20 years ago, and it still is relevant now for women. I am convinced that the women of the world united without any regard for national or racial dimension can become a most powerful force for international peace and brotherhood. And I think that's pretty relevant now. But I find it interesting that she said that almost 20 years ago. And the last person, Shirley Chisholm. For people in this country, everyone thinks that Barack Obama was the first, and I am a Barack Obama fan, okay? But everyone thinks that he's the first African-American to ever run for president. He's not. It's Shirley Chisholm. This woman was awesome, okay? Shirley Chisholm was the first African-American to run for the Democratic presidential nomination in 1972. And she is a role model of mine. I mean, if you have a chance to check out some of her quotes and check out her bio, she's really inspirational. And she was the first African-American woman in Congress. And last week was the 50th anniversary of her attaining that status. And she went on to serve 7 terms in the House of Representatives. She was a school teacher. And she decided that she really wanted to push the status quo. And spent 7 terms in the House of Representatives. And I love, once again, the saying that goes around nowadays, a lot of people are saying, I want a seat at the table, seat at the table. This was back, I think, probably in the 70s, where she said, they don't give you a seat at the table, bring a folding chair. So in other words, don't let that stop you. And lastly, this is my last slide. First women winners, 2018 U.S. midterms, 50 years after Shirley Chisholm, and it was stated in D.C. last week with the election and everything going on and all of the negatives that we have. But these are some of the first women. We have the first Muslim American woman in Congress, first Native American woman in Congress. I mean, it just goes on and on. So these are women that you might not necessarily see or hear about in the press here. But we're quite impressed and very excited about the ethnic women that are now in our state, in the U.S. Congress. So that's me done. Thank you very much.